our seventh meeting. So a lot of information that you all, thank you. Thank you very much, Lisa. So as we agreed before, if you all would indulge us in a moment of prayer before we start these meetings, as we agreed in the last time, I will appreciate that. Ms. Ashby?
What about the Lord's Prayer?
That's the only prayer Jesus prayed. That's the one.
That's good. I don't know, everybody knows that one.
That's true. Probably.
Well, let us pray.
Yes, sir.
Heavenly Father, we come to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you for another day. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for eternal forgiveness of sins. Forgive us of all of our wrongdoings. Lord Jesus, I ask you to take charge of this meeting. Show yourself who you are. And Lord, continue to plead the cause for the people. And again, we give you all the honor and the glory and the praise for the earth being yours and the fullness thereof, the world that they dwell therein. Thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Royce. So as usual, the format this evening is a little bit different than what we've done in the past. And so we're now finally getting to a space where we start digging in on the devil of the details. So you had the benefit of fantastic speakers. We're going to try to round out our speakers bureau this evening with another fantastic group of experts to bring to you kind of the last set of information that you need to know collectively to begin to do some small group work and really dig in on the devil of the details so that we can start really thinking through what works, what doesn't work. If it does work potentially, what additional information might you need to gather in order to make an educated decision in the next set of meetings that we had. So just by way of reminder, we got permission and authorization by you all and the powers that be to go ahead and extend this out two more meetings. So we got a lot of information to cover in these next set of meetings so that we can make sure that everybody is included and you have all the information that you need. So just by way of ground rules again, we ask that everyone be really, really respectful to each other. You guys have done an awesome job of that meeting after meeting. Keep in mind, the whole purpose of this is just to put all the information out on the table, work from that information in terms of what is appropriate for this particular community in terms of moving forward with whatever model you deem appropriate at the end of all of your deliberations. So with that, we will go ahead and move forward to the setup, and Salim will give you an explanation of exactly how this evening is going to work, and then we'll go from there.
All right, I'm going to try to use my teacher voice. I'll leave this here for the panelists. One of you, Mike. My experience facilitating this group is I need both hands. Can't be too tied up. I got to be flexible. So we're going to get started. This is for the working group members and community members. I just really want to highlight. Some people will be excited about this. Others may have a little bit of anxiety around it. But this is our last panel discussion. We have two more meetings after this, and we are going to start. Well, you will continue your deliberation as you attempt to narrow down what you see as the best model of models for the work moving forward. So this will be the last kind of talking head session, but what I want to encourage working group members to do is to think about the questions you need to ask as you think about what recommendations you want to make. And some of those questions we may be able to ask and get answered today, but if we can't answer them today, or we don't have time to ask them, bring those questions to us and we'll make sure that that will inform the agenda of the next meeting. Because we want to make sure you have all the information you need to feel comfortable making a decision. Does that make sense?
Yes.
I'm going to take the silence as a yes. I'm going to take the silence as a yes, so stop me if it does not. So just a quick recap. So we have our options and strategies that we're going to be discussing. They're listed on your handout. And then these key points to consider, these are not the questions we're going to be asking, but these are things to kind of help you maybe stimulate some questions for yourself. This information has been given to the panel ahead of time for them to reflect on. And we have two questions tonight, so I'm going to ask you to work with me. I'm going to ask two questions of the panelists. They're going to answer those questions based on their expertise and experience, and then we're going to break into small groups to formulate our questions and then come back to the panelists to ask those questions. So what that means is we are going to attempt to not ask questions in real time while in the middle of them talking. So that's going to be the challenge this evening. But again, being responsive to how the meetings have been flowing, we have been adjusting the agenda to try to make sure we accommodate the way the meetings are flowing. So we have two questions tonight. So I think you guys can work with me to get us through two questions, and then we will get to your questions. Royce?
Yeah, I just want to say you have, number one, historic preservation, but you have rehabilitation of units with some modernization. I don't think that part is, if that's our plan as the resident plan, that's not what we're talking about, with some modernization.
Give me a clarification, please.
We're talking about retrofitting and renovating to 21st century standards all 296 units.
100%.
Great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I can't spell now.
All right, so can we get started? Any other questions before we dig in? Yes, in the back, Ms. Hatcher.
This is quite misleading when it says understanding housing models and non-displacement strategies. To me, that means non-displacement means that the residents won't have to move out of Marin City. It doesn't mean that the buildings will still be in Marin City. There needs to be clarification of that. We don't want our buildings torn down. We don't. Right. Now, maybe some few people might, but we who live there don't want to lose our buildings. They have a lot of ethnicity to them, and a lot of feeling to them, and a lot of home ownership value to them. And eventually, we as a group might be able to purchase our property as a group. And it can happen. We can be a co-op. And we need to talk about that rather than the displacement, and that's, you know, misleading. And I don't like people trying to mislead people with double meanings to their words. We need more clarification.
Okay. I don't think anybody is in opposition to the fact that we want no displacement. Right, we want 100% return for all residents who want to return. So if I'm on the right page with that, that was the attempt. That was what was meant by non-displacement. So
that's,
if it was unclear, we apologize for that. But we're attempting to capture what's been said in several meetings, which is residents want to make sure they have the option to return. Residents do not want to be displaced. As a matter of fact, many residents hope that they don't have to even move out of their unit as rehabilitation happens.
That's right.
So I think, you know, so I apologize if non-displacement was unclear, but our goal was not to mislead. Our goal was to attempt to capture what's been happening in the meetings. Okay?
I still say, you said it again, non-displacement is that the people won't have to lose their places, or that we won't have to leave, but it doesn't mean that we won't have to lose our places, our tall buildings.
Right,
you see,
so,
what I'm saying?
Yes, I do.
I hear
both ends of that. And so part of what I think, so displacement is what potentially could happen to the people. So that's one of the things
right.
that we're trying to make sure it doesn't happen
right.
to the people, right?
I'm talking about.
And then
property.
About the buildings, it really boils down to where the working group lands in terms of recommendations. So if we land on a recommendation that says buildings stay the same height, they are only, they're not modernized, but they're brought to 21st century standards, that's really not my call. I'm here to help facilitate getting to that decision, but that's not my call.
I realize that, but you know, we want to keep our buildings.
understand
and that. And I want that to be clear.
I think that is clear. I think for me, not being from Marin, when you say we, it doesn't necessarily, I don't know if that includes everyone in the room. Either.
Everybody who lives in public housing, tall buildings.
Okay.
Or low-rise.
And low-rise. Excuse me. I stand corrected, Ms. McNamara.
All right, so let's get into our two questions. Question number one, and as a matter of fact, before we start, I apologize. Let me give a brief introduction, and please add anything to the introduction, because I'm going to work with what I have. So we have here with us this evening Mr. Ishmael Guerrero. He is an executive director of Housing Authority in Denver. We have also with us Mr. Andrew Lofton. He is the executive director of Housing Authority in Seattle, Washington. We also have Mr. Nick Runick, who is an attorney, and I'll have him give more detail, but my understanding is that he works specifically around public policy, around housing issues. These are three panelists tonight. They have come from their respective places to share their expertise with us. So I will start with the first question. I'm going to direct it at Mr. Runick based on his experience. So the question, Mr. Runick, is, with baseline resident projections, must MHA ensure with any of the options in terms of housing options? And tagging on to that, what are some of the best practices in those areas?
I'm going to go ahead and stand up because I had to fly here from Chicago today. So I sat on the plane for 4 hours, so I really don't want to sit while I talk. Just to give you a little more background about me, my name is Nick Brunick. I'm a partner in a law firm called Applegate & Thorne Thompson in Chicago. And our practice focuses solely on community development efforts. So efforts related to affordable housing, public housing, schools, creating new businesses in low-income neighborhoods, things of that nature. I also happen to serve as the board president of a nonprofit group called BPI. And before I started working at the firm, I worked at BPI. And at BPI, we've spent 45 years working on issues related to affordable housing, public housing, trying to help bring jobs and economic activity to low-income neighborhoods. And during my time at BPI, I spent a lot of time working with public housing residents around their issues and concerns related to public housing redevelopment in Chicago. So I have had a little bit of experience in my time working on tough issues, like the tough issues that you're facing, struggling with how best to deal with issues around redeveloping public housing or rehabbing public housing, and making those decisions within the context of a working group and in the context of working with other people. And what I'm here tonight and was came prepared to do was to talk briefly about what the baseline protections are that the housing authority here will have to follow related to tenants, the baseline protections for tenants in the process of trying to decide what to do around public housing rehab or redevelopment. Okay, so I'll try to give a broad overview and then sit down and let the other esteemed panelists weigh in. And I know we're also going to do breakout sessions where you can get into more detail. Number one, though, I would say the number one protection that the housing authority has to comply with is around protections embedded in the Declaration of Trust. Now you might say, what the heck is the Declaration of Trust? The Declaration of Trust is a legal document that is recorded in the public records against the land on which the public housing sits. So it's a legal document that's recorded in the public records against the land on which the public housing sits. And in that declaration of trust, it says that the housing authority cannot demolish or dispose of that land or that property without HUD's permission, without getting the permission of the federal government to do something with it. Okay? That makes sense? So that's one level of protection that a local public housing authority cannot just decide on its own to do what it wants to do with its property. The Declaration of Trust says to anybody who's interested in that land or that property, that if anybody wants to do anything with that land or that property, they have to go to the Public Housing Authority, and the Housing Authority has to go to Washington, D.C. and get approval from HUD. Okay? Now, related to that declaration of trust, federal law says that if you want to do anything with public housing, meaning you want to sell it, you want to mortgage it, you want to put an easement on it, you want to demolish it, before anything like that can happen, the Housing Authority has to pass a public resolution at its board meeting with a plan that it has developed with the input of residents requesting HUD's permission, Washington, D.C.'s permission, to demolish or dispose of or sell or mortgage or change the public housing. And again, that has to be done at a public meeting. It has to be based on a plan that has involved the input of the residents and the tenants. And then if you dig into the details of the federal statute and the regs, it talks about how HUD can only approve that plan if it is in the best interest of the tenants. And there's a bunch of standards in there about what that means. Now, I'm not naive enough to think, because remember, I have been engaged and involved in doing work with public housing residents, that that doesn't mean that Washington, D.C. or Public Housing Authority is always going to have in the front of their mind the best interests of the tenants. But what it means is that the law says they are supposed to make that decision with respect to what's in the best interest of the tenant based on a plan in which the tenants have been involved. Okay? Within that plan, HUD says that the Housing Authority has to replace any units that are demolished on a one-for-one basis. Okay? Now, again, what that means in any particular situation can be a little murky, because in some situations, and this gets back to the question raised at the beginning of the meeting here, in some situations that means that a plan could be approved to demolish housing and build new housing and provide vouchers. Okay? That is allowed, because that has been done in other cities, right? So I want to be clear about that. In some cities, people have made the choice, and HUD has approved plans that allow the demolition of some housing to be replaced by new housing plus vouchers. Okay? But, again, it's supposed to be based on a plan developed by the residents and in the best interest of the residents. That one-for-one replacement rule, actually, if home or CDBG money, certain federal dollars, are used to demolish the housing, then every single one of the units has to be replaced one-for-one as another hard unit. Then you can't use vouchers to fill in the bin. Does that make sense? So I know I'm getting into the details, and maybe it's better to get into the working groups to talk about, but if certain federal dollars are used to demolish public housing, then you have to replace each hard unit one for one. Okay, yeah.
So, I know the biggest thing that I kind of keep wondering is how, you know, all that you said is good and fine, but there seems to be this thing where they replace a unit, but that unit goes on the market and it's not affordable. Or, you know, that seems to be the trend. You know, they said up here on this hill that they put some people up there, but they couldn't afford to stay there.
Right.
So, and then they make like a statement that's low income. Well, low income in Marin County is, I think it's like 40 something. It's way too high. It doesn't comply. So if you say, okay, we're going to replace one-to-one with affordable housing or low income, then that just eliminates a lot of people that live there now. They wouldn't be able to afford it.
You are exactly right that in a lot of places around the country with public housing redevelopment, that has happened, mm-hmm. that it's not affordable. What I will say is that when you are replacing one-to-one, you are supposed to be creating an affordable unit that is affordable to the public housing residents whose unit has been replaced. Okay? And that has happened in some places. Right. So what's very important is to recognize what's in the law and then the right questions to be asking and bringing forward through the working group, okay? Because your point is right. That's very important to make sure that the replacement housing for public housing families needs to be affordable at the public housing family level, not at 60% of the area median income for Marin County.
Yeah.
And I'm confident that our panelists are going to have some information that are going to trigger more questions for us. And this is how we get off. So I'm asking again if we can hold questions to the end. Mm. You can write them down,
okay.
Get in your working groups, and you can actually formulate them a little tighter. And then you will have small group breakouts with the panelists to ask very
okay.
specific and detailed questions. But if you don't hold to the time, then we won't get to that point.
Okay.
So I'm going to try to move us forward. I'm going to ask Mr. Brunick to continue his points from the Declaration of Trust.
So we,
and then I see you home. If I say yes to you, then I have to say yes to every other person. So I'm asking.
You opened the door.
She jumped in, and I couldn't shut her down quick enough.
And I didn't cross the ground with
a sidebar.
But I will say this. I know I'm going to be in one of the breakout sessions where we can get into more detail. I'm happy to.
And that's the goal. I mean, we're hoping that it's not. We don't want to just talk at you. We want you guys to have time to engage with the panelists. So we wanted to have them do an overview and then have you go into those smaller groups, which is the goal. So, Mr. Burton, you continue with your main points from the Declaration of Trust.
So I have two more points to go, which is, so we talked about the Declaration of Trust, right? We talked about the one-for-one replacement rule, and we talked about the process that a housing authority has to go through with HUD, with a plan, to get approval to do any changes. Okay, so we talked about those three protections. The other two protections I just want to mention are, the fourth being the public housing lease. Okay, the public housing lease is based on certain provisions in federal law that require that the lease be renewed each year, unless there is a, material default under the lease, meaning that someone is breaking provisions of the lease, that lease needs to be renewed each year. And because of the protections in that lease, if a housing authority goes to do something to change the development, the tenant is protected under the lease and is required to get replacement housing or assistance with finding a housing that is as affordable as the housing that they live in currently. Okay. Fifth and finally, and related to that point, is the issue of relocation assistance, okay? So I heard very clearly earlier how there's a lot of concerns about the possibility that someone might have to move. Even if you have to move temporarily, let's say that there's a plan that everyone agrees to that involves rehabbing apartments. And in order to rehab the apartments effectively, folks actually need to move for a month or 2 months to rehab the apartments. In that case, federal law requires that the public housing authority provide every single tenant with sufficient notice that that's coming, with public meeting or individual meetings and interactions to make sure that they are getting the tenant is getting the information they need about the move. Moving expenses have to be paid. Expenses related to moving there and back have to be paid. And then if there's any change in the rent, if the public housing tenant moves out of public housing to another apartment for a couple months while things are being rehabbed, if there's any difference in the rent between those two places, the public housing authority has to make up the difference in the rent. Does that make sense? Okay. So that's what's in the law. So every tenant is entitled to get relocation assistance. So I'm going to stop there. I think those are the kind of the big five major protections that I would point to that within any process, with whatever you decide to do here, those rights have to be respected. And I'll stop there.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Thank you.
Ms. DeLock, would you like to add anything?
Can we have the lights on?
Sure. And could you each introduce yourself again, because I was quick enough, right? All the names down.
Thank you. There should be a bio sheet in your packet. There should be a sheet in the packets that have bios of all the panelists tonight.
So I will introduce myself. I'm Andrew Lofton. I'm the Executive Director of the Sale Housing Authority. I've been at the Housing Authority for a little over 12 years. I've been the Executive Director for just about three. And at Seattle, we have done five Hope Six projects, and in the middle of doing our largest redevelopment at Yesler Terrace, which is a choice neighborhood project. And these are HUD programs, so I don't know if you are familiar with them or not, but they're redevelopment programs that HUD has provided some seed dollars to, and the housing authorities have used those dollars to redevelop their public housing sites. And we've done, as I said, five Hope Six projects, three of which were what we call garden communities. Each of them were on about 100 acres of property. We doubled the density of those properties. We actually disposed of all the public housing that was on that property. And we redeveloped the property into a mixed income community and replaced all of the housing one for one, as Mr. Burnick had just mentioned. And we've had a couple of different strategies to do that. In three of our garden communities, Hope Six properties, we replaced the housing, roughly two-thirds of it we replaced on site, and another third we replaced in different parts of the city. All replaced with hard units, all eligible rents for public housing eligible tenants, provided those tenants with relocation opportunities while the development was underway, and movement back into the properties if they so choose. Many of them chose not to come back to the property. That's their choice. They are counseled at the beginning of the redevelopment of all of the options that they have for relocation. They are told that the housing authorities, what the housing authorities are responsible for, as Mr. Burnick just described, moving expenses, payment of the rent for the new place or where they're at, moving expenses back to the property. And in some cases, they are also offered vouchers if they would prefer to have a voucher. They have that choice. They don't have to take it, but they do have that choice to be offered a voucher. And if they so choose, they can use that voucher both to relocate and live temporarily and come back, or permanently if they find a place that they feel more comfortable with and not wanting to come back. But it is their choice to do. And they, one of the sort of practices that we have that we go through is at the beginning of the process, once the decision has been made to redevelop, each resident gets a one-on-one counseling session with a counselor that's expert in relocation to go through all of the options that are available to that family. And they meet with them on multiple occasions to make sure they understand all the options, give them the ability to take their time to choose an option, and once they choose the option, to help them implement that choice. And so we're responsible for making sure that that process is completed with each of the individual tenants in the actual relocation effort. And as I said, in those three properties, about two-thirds of the individuals came back to the property, and about a third of the, or two-thirds of the units were replaced back on site, and about a third of the units were replaced in other places of the city. The reason why that was done was that there was a specific goal on the part of the housing authority in conjunction with our city government to deconcentrate our public housing. Those three properties had three quarters of our public housing in them, and they were all situated in three different areas in the poorest parts of the city. And one of the express goals when we went into that redevelopment was not only to redevelop those communities and transform those into mixed income communities, but also to do something that would deconcentrate the number of low income units that were in those properties as well. So those units that were located off site were located in non low income areas in the city. which was one of the objectives of the city and the housing authority. And that has actually worked out pretty well from our perspective. The fourth garden community that we're developing, we just started it, it's called Yesler Terrace, and it's one of the largest redevelopments that we've ever done. And we have a 30-acre site that had 561 units of public housing on it. And we are taking that 561 unit site, we are demolishing the public housing that's on that site, and we are renovating, redeveloping the site, and to include up to 5,000 units on that site. When we do that, we're replacing all of the public housing. All 561 units will be replaced on that site. We're also adding another 300 affordable housing units at what's called tax credit levels, 60% of area median income. Units that don't exist in the city today for affordability purposes. And in addition to that, we're adding another 850 workforce units for individuals, nurses, teachers, that level of profession that have a hard time affording units that in the city of Seattle today. So with that plan, we have initiated that plan already. We went through the same process, meeting with all 500 families, giving them all their choices, some of which wanted vouchers, most of which wanted to come back to the property. And we committed to every single family that they had the right to come back to and redevelop Yesler Terrace. And we did that commitment, and we provided for each family a certificate that was signed by the executive director that gave them legal rights to come back to the property upon its completion. And we will honor those certificates as we continue the redevelopment. So one of the, from our perspective, best practices around whether it's redevelopment or renovation is the communication with the residents often and early. And our communication, our commitment to our residents in the Yesler Terrace redevelopment is 18 months before they have to move, we will start the process with them. If we do not talk to them in 18 months, they do not have to leave until 18 months after our first contact with them on relocation. That's also something that we have committed to publicly. It is something that we committed to our city government, and it's something we committed directly to our residents. So we start that communication process 18 months out, before anyone has to move, and we provide them all the options that they have before them, and over that 18 months, help them decide which of those options are best for their family. And once they choose that option, we then will help them with all of the required cost of moving to a new place. The other thing I guess would be helpful to know about that process is when we do that, or when we did that, we also went to the residents to say, well, you help us prioritize how we will identify the folks who have the first choice of coming back and the first choice they're going to be impacted for relocation. And through a process similar to this, the residents got together and said, the first priority of folks having a choice of when they move should be families with children. Because we want to minimize the disruption of their school time. So usually there's a window between the end of school and the beginning of school where families are going to move. That's the best time for them to do it so that the children's school isn't disrupted. So when we start that 18-month clock, we target that window between school years for families with children in school to be able to make their moves at that point in time. And we also then target, when they come back, that next period of time for those families, so that the new school they were at, or whatever school they happen to be in, they also don't have to be disrupted through their school aged periods. So that has worked really well for us. We have relocated 220 of the 500 families that were on site. We have opened up one building and already in the redevelopment, and 40 of those families have come back to Fiesta Terrace already. We're opening up another building in about 4 months, and we have a waiting list of existing residents who will either come back from relocation or will move from an existing unit into the new unit where they don't have to be relocated at all. And that's happening as we manage that on a day-to-day basis with all of our residents, because we've set up this kind of a conversation with them, and we have counselors that meet with them on a regular basis, one-on-one, to keep them informed about the progress of the project, about where they are and their choice, the choices they have to make, and the options that they have. And when they do make those options, we're there to execute them with them.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Lofton. Mr. Guerrero, I'm going to ask you to go to the start off on the second question for the sake of time. So
all right.
This last question is really asking our panelists, based on what they've learned about Marin City, the Housing Authority properties here, and based on their experience, which of the models do they think are viable? What are the challenges around funding? What type of partners would you may need? So if you could speak to your experience, so much you understand
Excuse
about
me.
Marin City Housing.
Young,
yes.
You know, the gentleman from Chicago.
Yes.
You could place Marin City inside my park. Okay? Marin City is very small and very unique, and I don't think you guys really understand how unique we are. You're basing us on where you live.
Ms. Ashby, I apologize, I have to cut you off, just because your questions are important and I want to get to the point where we can actually ask
them. Had we been able to say something as they were talking, because they have their points of interest, and we need to be able to dialogue through this thing. You guys are here to resolve us from speaking. That's what the conflict resolution thing is. And I hate to be disruptive, but it's important that we be able to get our point across, because otherwise, all this stuff that I've written, I have to go in a small group and be with other people and let them have their say, and I'll never be able to get all the questions that I have based on what they say out. And you guys are creating this kind of atmosphere to keep us from talking. And it's not fair. It's really not fair that you guys are here in the first place. We don't even know you. We have a unique community.
Okay.
We don't want to lose our community like they're able to tear their buildings down. We don't want that. So now, Mr. Jordan came here with his mind made up to tear down the tall buildings. He's never lived there. My thought is that people who work for public housing should live there, so they know what we're going through.
Ken, is it possible we could move the meeting forward?
I wanted to get my point across before you go forward.
I understand that, Ms. Ashby, and I'm sure.
I mean, it's necessary, because otherwise I'm going to lose my
groups.
I'm going to lose my point of view, and that's what you want us to do.
Many folks have many questions. The goal of the small groups is
just
actually
to keep us
from doing it. So you're not trying to. Not, you don't have 25 people each trying to make 10 points, but 10 people going over their 10 points and pulling out what they think makes sense and bringing it back. So
you
we're only trying, if you guys have a better strategy,
you
we will work with you, but
you're
our goal
skilled.
Is not to shut you down.
You're skilled in what you do. Conflict resolution. You're resolving us from making any conflict
in these people's presentation. You keep bringing people here from other housing authorities and basing what we do on what they're doing. And it's not fair. And I'm really upset about this, and you're not going to keep me quiet.
I can tell.
I mean, these people ought to know. If they stayed in Marin City for a week, they would see what we're going through. You guys have brought new people there who are disruptive and ignorant and apathetic to our community. We've got new people that are really not welcome.
The decision will be made by those who live here and the working group. These panelists are only here to share what they know. I don't think any of the panelists are attempting to say.
Ours will be based on what they're doing. We don't need to know what they're doing.
Yours will be based on what you decide. This is just information. So this is, they are not going to control the decision.
I could read a book and learn what they're talking about.
So I'm going to ask, if we can, to have them respond to the last question. And if that's not the best solution, then you tell me what you think we should do.
You're a very learned man. You're real smart.
This is your process.
Oh, really?
I'm not here to short-circuit your process.
Yes, you are. Yes, you
so
are.
So I'm asking the question.
And you're doing it well.
I'm asking the question. Can we continue with the last question? Or is there a different...
Is there another question, or is there another presentation?
We have one more question that each panelist is going to respond to, and then we will be going to working group members and resident questions. So, Mr. Guerrero, please.
Thank you. Good evening, since you don't know me well, and obviously I don't know all of you in the room. I'm Ismael Guerrero. I have been at the Denver Housing Authority for 8 years now. And the common theme here to the lady's comments is that we have, those of us up here have experience with this, obviously not here in Marin City, but I'll share with you as Andrew did. In Denver, we have completed three redevelopments of the same size, you know, 250 to 300 units, public housing. We've been able to successfully do a redevelopment of those, very similar to, but slightly along the lines of what Seattle did, but it's really each community, each neighborhood, frankly, is different. In Denver, we've completed three. We've done we followed the games of the rules of the game, as Nick really well laid them out. Those are the rules of the game that we all have to follow as public housing authorities, from the one-for-one replacement, the resident approval. And so forth. So we've been through that process with three different communities in Denver. Each of them had a unique solution. There was unique neighborhoods, unique communities. This week, we're having meetings very similar to this with our residents of the Sun Valley neighborhood. That's 250 units of public housing in a neighborhood in Denver. We're coming up with a unique vision for that community with the residents and with the larger community as well. So I know we're pressed for time, so I don't want to dwell on that too much. Looking forward to answering the individual questions. To the question that I was asked about the options that you're looking at, that you're considering, that were listed out here, our experience, and again, this is a Denver experience, so not to say that it's the right one for here, but our experience has been that what we learned, actually, what we heard from our residents was both displacement concerns, as well as the concerns about how is this overall going to improve the quality of my life, right? You know, just having a new unit, even a rehab unit, doesn't necessarily improve the quality of life. And so what we've been doing with our residents through the process has really been to come up with a shared vision through a whole lot of meetings like this. It sounds like you're at the beginning of the process. It's a long one. A lot of conversations, a lot of questions, a lot of options to consider. It's one we've been through. Our approach has been to do, and when we redevelop these, is to do replacement of the housing. So we have been tearing down the old buildings. We found that they were obsolete. While they may look good on the outside, we were having a lot of issues like elevators constantly breaking down. We had a lot of infrastructure that needed to be replaced that's very expensive, sewers, water lines, and things like that. And so collectively, through a process, we came up with a shared vision to replace them, to add additional units, so we had more affordable. We did one-for-one replacement, plus we did additional affordable units on top of, in addition to the ones that were there before. And we also added some market rate units. Our model, we were able to do about a third of each, so our, which meant the size of the development would increase from 250 units to maybe 600 units. So we could bring back all the units that were there before, plus add additional ones. That allowed a lot of new services to come into the community. We brought new partners. We expanded daycare centers. We heard through visioning processes what was needed in the neighborhood, whether it was jobs, better access to healthcare, better schools, more early childhood education or opportunities, things like that. And so as we went through this process, we were building in not just a housing strategy, but really a community revitalization strategy. And that was very important to the residents. Not just to the residents, frankly, but to the larger community. It was a vision that was shared by the residents, by the neighbors of our property, by the city, and by the housing authority. And once we had that shared vision, then we had a plan that we were moving forward on to execute. Two other things that have worked well for us is we've done phasing, which means as best we can, we're building replacement units first before we do any of any of the buildings that are going to be demolished, and then we will move so the residents can move into new units before wherever they're currently living would be demolished, and that would be as best we can. We've been able to do it on site. You have to get very creative. Again, this is Golden Gate City here. It's unique. You have a lot of land to work with, but you need to be creative about the strategy, and something that I'm sure you'll be working on over the next several years, potentially. I know that's how long it's been taking us. Our Sun Valley development, we're about into year four of the planning process. We finally got a master plan that everybody has agreed to, and we're getting ready to implement. So this is a process. But those are some of the key things. The last thing I would say that's worked for us is, as Andrew mentioned, the choice about whether you stay or go for individual families to make, as well as the return policies. And for us, it's been, as you've heard from others, our policy was to allow everybody who wanted to return the opportunity to return. And we've been able to make that commitment stick and hold for the ones that we've been able to do in Denver. So I'll just stop there because I know we want to get in some individual questions on the other panelists.
Thank you, Mr. Guerrero.
The only thing I want to add and reiterate is that I am not here, nor any of the panelists are here, to try to convince you to do it Seattle's way or our way. What I think we can add to this conversation is simply a recognition of what this process that you're involved in is the right process. It's a process that we have all gone through in our own communities. Because each of our communities have passionate individuals about the places where they live. It is their home. And it's something that they have always cherished. And they do cherish quite a lot. And we started the same conversations at the same place of don't change my home. And we have had those conversations to describe the challenges that are before us in terms of continuing to maintain that home without doing something to it, and what that means for the residents of that property and what it means for the rest of the community. Because the more dollars that we spend on a project that is failing, the less dollars we have to spend in our community to help other low-income people. And that's a high priority for us, is how many people can we serve. So we are trying to be smart about how we manage our revenue and our dollars, and smart about how we support our residents. They deserve safe, decent places to live. And if we can manage that within the context of the current envelope, we would do that. If we can't manage it within the current envelope, we have to share that with our residents and let them know why. And through that process, it has been difficult at times, but it has been successful in that we all come to a common vision of what our objectives are and what are the things that are most important to us, and what our priorities are. And when we come to that point, it doesn't happen overnight, but it does happen. When we come to the point where we agree that these are the objectives or the goals that we have to meet, then we can move together to create something that both the housing authority as well as the residents feel are important to them.
So we're going to close out with Mr. Brunick, and then we're going to have an opportunity for the residents.
I want to ask this gentleman something. How would you like somebody to come into your community and tell you you have 18 months to get, or however long, to get out of your house what you took 10 and 15 years to put in there? How would you like that? You're going to come to our community and tell us what you did tearing down those people's buildings. Each and every one of you want to tear our buildings down. That's the only reason you're getting paid to be here. Airplane tickets and all that stuff. You're getting paid to be here. We don't need you or him here.
I'm not here to suggest to tear down a
building.
That's
what you've been doing, telling us what you did in your community. We don't care.
Right.
So I would like to...
Let her speak.
We
don't need you. We don't need you. You need to get your butt and all these RFD or whoever you guys are. We need you to go. Because we can deal with these people here on our own.
So here's
Mr.
where we
Jordan,
are.
We can talk to him. He ought to be up there.
I apologize that that's
he ought to be up here. Mr. Jordan and us need to talk.
What I would like to do
is shut me up so you can keep making your money.
What I'd like to do is to hear from the working group. So I'm going to, short of anybody stopping me, I'm going to hijack this process.
Well, Royce is on the working group. She wanted to speak.
We can take a quick break. I've got Mr. Brunick. I don't even want you to respond to the last question. I want to open this up to working group members for any questions that you may have. If you would like to take a break first, if you would like to caucus with other members in your break, you can do that. But it sounds like there are a lot of questions in the room, and we should take advantage of the panelists and ask those questions. But because we only have two meetings after this one, I would like to prioritize the questions coming from working group members who will be making the recommendations in terms of where you guys go with your rehabilitation / redevelopment. So that's my proposal. If anyone has any objections, please make them now.
It's not an objection, it's a on course for what we had planned for the evening in terms of working group members and residents and community members who are here this evening. We were going to do a breakout session in small groups so that you guys could have one-to-one conversations with our guests tonight. So I would like to hear from working group members whether or not you still would like to break down into small groups so that you can have one-to-one conversations with these individuals. And I'd like you to do that by a show of hands. So basically what we have planned to do is have two working groups, two small group sessions, one with Mr. Lofton and one with Mr. Guerrero, where working group members would be able to formulate questions, talk to them about what you've heard so far in this process, and get more clarity. Residents who are here would have an opportunity to go into a small group with Mr. Vernon and ask him questions about his work around resident protection. If in fact you are a resident who feels like you want to actually talk to one of the housing authority members, you are welcome to join one of those working groups. But remember that these are breakout working sessions where you as individual working group members need to be picking these people's brains so that you can make an informed decision. So I would like to see a show of hands from working group members about whether or not you want to engage in this breakout session process or you want to continue in this large group process.
I have a question.
Yes.
Will we, if we break out, will we be able to hear what the residents are saying in their group?
We're coming back. There will be a report back so that we'll all come back together so that you can hear what residents say. Residents can hear what you say. There will be a facilitator, a recorder, and a presenter for each of the small groups so that you will have time to discuss, formulate questions, talk directly to them, and then when we come back and reconvene as a large group, the presenter from each small group will tell us what happened in your work meeting or in your small breakout session. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, my question or comment is, after hearing the three, no one has still addressed anything that has been resident-driven at all. Do you not have residents that are leaders, that you support, that you work with? How come we haven't heard anything about resident-driven?
In your small group sessions.
No. The whole group needs to hear.
So the question is, would the working group members prefer to break into small groups or stay in large groups?
So, yes,
yeah,
large
groups. Sure, hold on,
hold on. That's not the question. The question is this. The panel. This panel here, the panel before them, and the panel before them have all explained.
The same thing.
What they've done in their communities. We don't care.
This is the process mandated by HUD. So what I'm saying to you is this, is that there are multiple ways to get feedback.
And
what we are going to figure out, and why we've changed into this format, because honestly, the last structure to get collective feedback wasn't working. All right? So what we're saying is this, everyone will have an opportunity to get all of their questions out, hear everybody's point of position without a few dominating the conversation and moving forward. What we're going to do is level the playing field.
But we're hearing one view that's dominating.
True.
I'm just
setting the stage. I'm not just counting your questions. Okay. So what I want to make sure we get time to do is actually get into the working groups to dig in, because your question is valid. But he can only really answer the question in the working group session, so we can bring that to the full body.
Why can't we discuss that?
Because that's not the structure.
Can we go back to the short meeting?
That's not your plan.
We're just
going to
move to the room.
May I just ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes.
I think it's a great idea if we can do both. If we can take some more time right now to not, I really don't want to see like this whole thing happen where this defensive thing builds up again. And I feel that we're a small enough group here today. We don't really need to break into smaller groups. I think it would be good if we did, you know, people had questions and we went around respectively.
So perhaps you're not hearing me. I'm saying that you will do small group work, and
no,
then you
I'm will requesting that we have this more, okay. More time.
No, I hear you, Aura, I do. But what I'm saying, so what I'm saying is that yes, you will have an opportunity to work in small groups. We will reconvene as a large group, and you will have an opportunity then.
But you're telling us. I'm just suggesting maybe the working group matters.
I put it out to the entire working group as to which process you, as working group members, would like to hear. I'm not telling you. I'm saying that all working group members should weigh in on whether or not they want to go into a small group process.
But I just want 5 more minutes of open. I just want a little more time so we can hear and get the press.
Hold on, Lisa.
Hello.
You all are saying the same thing.
Can we just stick to what they plan to do?
In a democratic process, she's calling the question and saying, you have a recommendation. There's another recommendation. Which one is the preference of the collective body? And we move forward is the point, right?
So can I see a show of hands from working group members? Would you like to go into small group sessions and speak directly to these individuals? A show of hands from working group members.
But not now. That's the question. Now we do it now.
Do they live in public housing?
So six of the working group members said they'd like to go into small groups. The concern I have is that we're already behind time.
Exactly.
So if we go into small groups, you will have less time to formulate your questions, and then we can come back. So there were six working group members who said they would like to break into small groups. So the other option is, because
so that's the consensus.
Everybody has to say.
So.
No, but now. You said we all get to hear each other now.
How many working group members would like to stay in the large group?
Let's hear what other
people. Let me ask that again. All right, you may have missed the question.
No, the other
one. So the question is, how many working group members would like to stay in the large group? One, two, three, four,
four.
It was six for the other.
It was 16, and so based on the vote of the working group members, we are going to go into small groups.
Now, just a point of information, I just want to say that most of us, the second go-around was residents of Golden Gate Village.
I hear you. I noticed the same thing. I noticed exactly the same thing. So, with that, what I want to make certain that everybody's, these folks have volunteered to come and provide context and information. Zero judgment. Zero judgment about what is good and what is bad. And so my concern is, please do not attack these gentlemen that have come just to say what's in the universe. Because what I've heard from the first meeting, second meeting, third meeting, fourth meeting, all to today is we are concerned because we have residents that are not educated on the process, the strategies, and whatnot. And to your point, Ms. Ashby, you are absolutely right. Shame on us if we allow ignorance to prevail and prevent the knowledge across the board. Whether we like the idea or love the idea, we have a collective obligation to put the information into the universe so people can make an educated decision about what's good for their lives. So, their lives, the individuals who are making the decisions, residents, impacted, community-based organizations, everybody. So, one, please, again, small group, not small group, please do not take your frustration, anger, disappointment out on these gentlemen who have come a long way just to say, look, this is how it happened in my city. It's just fact.
Nobody's doing that.
But
so let's get over
it. I just want to make sure, because that's where
we'd
it felt like
to
it was
just
going.
Go on and hear from them, and I'd like,
excuse
me. It'd be great if we had transparency and we all could hear each other's stories.
Oh, but okay, so my question is, like Royce put it on the floor, we keep hearing from all these people offering their testimonials of what happened where they were, and it was all driven by non-residents. Wait a minute, no. She asked them, she said, and that's who we want to talk to. We want to talk to residents who took over and were successful. We don't want to keep talking to the same type of people. We talk to the same, y'all bring the same type people to sit in front of us to tell us how y'all tore down y'all buildings and put the people back in their buildings. We want to hear from some people that the project was predominantly resident driven and they were successful.
Amen.
That's who I want to hear from.
Amen.
And we can get there. This is my point. You're absolutely right. What I'm saying is we cannot afford to have selective listening. What I heard in their presentation was this. It is mandated by law that you have a resident participation. Now, driven is all subjective, right? So, and again, the ability for you to ask very detailed questions, which I heard from you, Royce, in the last meeting, which was, explain to me better, what was the resident participation, right? Those are the kinds of questions that we can do the deep dive on as we get there. But again, the question that isn't really specific, like you asked last week, doesn't help us get there. So to say, I haven't heard anything about resident driven is very different than your question last week, which is, explain to me, in whatever model, how you actually did this, what was the involvement of the council? All those are fantastic and appropriate questions. What I'm saying is that the way that questions are being framed suggests that it is a combative scenario where we're trying to do a deeper dive on what they do.
That's just because you have not allowed the residents the floor as a panel. You always make us sit and listen to your made up panels. You don't never have us take the floor
at
the panel.
That's
we always have to sit here and have you tell us what we're going to ask and how we're going to say and how we're going to do it.
That's right.
You always dictate that,
so
not us.
That's right.
You run the first panel, who?
You run the beast.
President.
No,
right.
You didn't
the
give her
panel.
The time to do it. She ran out of time.
The first panel,
yeah. By the time he gets through.
No, come on now. Don't go there.
Thank you, Ms. Ashby. You are absolutely correct. So I'm going to
stop
talking now.
Stop BSing me, okay?
No.
You guys always dictate what we're supposed
to
do.
All right?
I'm from Chicago. I know all about BS.
Lisa?
Okay.
Which groups are going where?
I'm
They want to go into the working groups or the sessions.
We're going to ask the questions.
Who's going where?
So, can we count off 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2?
Have they ever had the residents on the panel?
Never.
No.
That was with the residents at the beginning.
Have you ever seen a panel with the residents?
Other than the one when I gave the presentation.
Royce, you're a two?
No, I'm not doing it.
You're a none?
No.
You're a none right now?
Nobody wants to be involved in your stuff.
We're not in your stuff now, are we?
We're breaking into small groups.
We're all getting paid to be here.
So I want one vote here.
That's what they decide to do. That's what I'm saying. They come in and tell us what we gonna do.
That's right.
They don't put it to a vote to us.
One vote here.
They come up with the agenda.
And any resident that is interested.
Every meeting.
You say right back here.
They come up with an agenda. We don't have nothing to do with what the agenda is. The resident council wasn't in that meeting. So I'm wondering, how come I don't get to hear from the resident council? We went to Samford, the resident council wasn't even there from that.
We don't need any answers.
No, they weren't.
I told you that there were three members that were there, and I would bring them here. I would bring them here any day of the week.
They weren't at that meeting, they did not speak.
But they were there. I can't make folks speak if they don't speak. Right? But at the end of the day, I'm guaranteeing that they were there.
And when are y'all gonna ask us how we want a meeting to go? We the residents, y'all never once consulted us what y'all want to happen.
Last meeting we were here, right?
And what did y'all ask us?
I said, I will actually have a resident-only meeting to do exactly what you suggested. Exactly what you said. I will bother. Tell me the date and time.
That's what me and you supposed to talk. You never returned the call.
I told Royce. I've not heard not one piece since I said that.
And see, what's making me upset right now is we're supposed to go into these rooms and talk to these people who tell us the same thing. That's all they're going to do is tell us the same thing you've been telling us every meeting.
Yes, we have been successful in bringing Terry Dong and putting people back in their apartments.
Okay.
So this is what
I want to hear that one more time.
I approve this feedback because it says to me, hey, so next meeting or the resident meeting, I'm like, where do you want the residents to come from? Was my number one question. All right, is it Hunter's View? Is it Oakland? Is it Richmond? Where do you want them to come from? Because that's what we do. Just like we got these folks. But again, I don't drive that process. That's for a resident-driven process. I gave my calendar open.
I guess I'm not sure. I wouldn't mind sticking around, but I don't know how many hours this is going to go for.
What's going on? Why haven't we heard more about the resident information? Why it ain't on the board, the cable does all the time?
That is a great point.
Right.
Again, just like
I should be, if you don't have a resident,
we're essentially really looking at.
Let's go back around that conversation. I just want to clarify, we had a conversation about resident experts and the fact that we wanted to see that happen. And I said, yes. You told me you're going to give me a list of names.
No. Me? I said me.
Well, I need more than
But that goes to Beverly's point. Bringing you back would be just like us keeping info back.
I'm talking about.
So wait, can I finish?
We have a plan.
We have a plan. It don't never come up. We don't never talk. They have a plan.
The only plan that we really heard was.
We need to see some experts for your plan here on the panel. We don't need to see no more housing authorities.
So,
he's not from the housing.
No, I was just sharing.
Are you understanding what you're saying? I do hear you work with residents, and we don't have anyone like them in Marin.
No, but I want to share with him.
And you share with him what I'm seeing.
All right, so for the purpose, I get your point, and I get your point, but I want to make sure that everybody here understands who this gentleman is, right? But I want to make sure everybody.
We don't have a comparable attorney in Marin County or in the state.
Which is why he was particularly recruited and brought to having different kind of conversations.
But also, doesn't make people see that what we don't have that kind of protection and representation.
But you. Right, and
yeah, but I mean, that's one night. It's not, yeah, I know.
See, this looks just like another ginger cake.
No, but it's really
that's
time. All
that looks
okay.
Like.
That's what
right, so,
how much you use.
So how do we make it look mean?
So this is one thing that I do want somebody to hear. All right, the one thing I do want you to hear, why I appreciate, I'm with the
happy to share some ideas,
is that when we started the process, and I'm not condoning or suggesting that you should do what San Francisco did. But, so I just want to start there. So what I am saying is that before we began the conversation, I asked the city to set aside $300,000 in a legal fund that should they break the all the things that he just walked on, that they would have their own resources to hire their attorney to help them walk through and hold the city accountable. All I'm saying is that
by the time they get through going through the red tape, mumbo jumbo, half of us will be dead.
No, what I'm saying is it doesn't matter the model. If you even put historic preservation as the model, still all residents need to understand resident protections associated with that.
So we know a lot of regs, a lot of us do, but we don't have the legal representation to back us up.
Okay,
all
right.
I've had that with all the residents,
but now.
That would be great.
We know
that's not going to happen.
No, it's just that we don't have legal representation that coming forward as a resident isn't always effective.
Well, I want him to hear our plan and that we do have a real plan.
You do understand that to give him the plan is to suggest he's an authority. I'm saying that's a good or bad plan.
He's an attorney. We're just presenting there is another plan.
Let us talk.
He knows that.
He don't know about the
plan. Yes, he does. He has sent all the information about every presentation. Every presentation.
So you know about the presentation you guys are getting paid to be here.
Okay.
How much are you guys getting paid to be here?
We're wasting our time.
So let's do this. Why don't I hear what your ideas are, and then why don't I share with you off of your ideas what I've seen some other residents groups do to make sure that A, their rights are protected, but also how they push their vision
to do a reality.
Yeah. So
two things before we get there. I'm assuming you're going to be a spokesperson post.
Yes. Well, I'm the vice president.
No. In terms of the report out.
Okay.
All right, so I just want to make sure we know who's doing what when we're done. All right.
Because see, I just want to say this up front. The Resident Council of Marin City has not been supported or embraced. So there comes the first incident of no trust.
Right. Now,
Wait a minute.
Okay, yes, go ahead, Kelly.
Your other dude gave away the meeting place that we were supposed to have. So now we don't really have no place.
And Louis Jordan gave
then one day we get a place and then somebody changes the locks. So it's just been, it looks, and then you come up with all this money to have y'all come in.
We over here struggling. We got to meet in the little bitty old room. With Royce and, you know, people.
Okay.
Now, I'm just saying, we got to get in that little bitty room in her place, right?
That's right.
So it just, it don't look too good. And then every time we come here, they tell us, now this is what we're going to talk about. We decide what the questions will be, and we're going to choose who we get to answer the questions. And now we're going to tell you to break off into a group and listen to these people tell you how they get what they get. And so my thing is, I done heard enough of what they did. I'm wanting to find out how we can become empowered to make something happen. And if you got a group of people that did that somewhere that empowered us, because we have not been empowered by Marin Housing Authority. The resident council has not been empowered. Nobody been here. We got your back. We got your back. What y'all want to do? Let's do something. Let's do something. They ain't been like that with Royce. They've been fighting her tooth and nail for a decade. Took a school from her. So it does not look like they are for us.
Well, take it even a little step further. We had to go to federal court in 2012-13
for the resident council
to have the resident established by the Marin Housing Authority
to have a local
a council. They took away
council.
Our rights in 2009. And then in 10 they began to evict us out of our place that was community place for the residents. Be gone in Jesus' name.
Hold on.
I want to talk to you. We can talk to you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Son of the Living God, be gone. Satan, be gone in Jesus' name. I plead the blood of the Lamb up against you in Jesus' name. The devil is a lie. Satan, be gone. Be gone. I plead the blood of Jesus up against you. The blood of Jesus. Our plan. You want to have a seat? Oh, well, you did.
No, I saw you pointing at.
Oh yeah, I said you're the one that twisted up the HUD regulations so twisted and convoluted that we had to go to federal court to get our basic rights restored.
Ilya, can you step away so they can actually talk?
Yeah,
talk
about yeah. That you gonna do something?
I had to sit up so they could talk. So I just put y'all on talk to you.
So our plan is not a one-time fix.
what I bring in is to create a path of local which is a shared ownership. What does that mean? That means that there's three different things. The first maintenance. There's still a smidgen of an opportunity to be able to get the $14 million. There was $14 million in Marin County that had not been spent. September next month, the end of the month, is when it goes to the regular treasury, because they would rather let it go back to the treasury as well as $14 million when you've got $200-$500 million, you know, development project. So, first and foremost, when all going back to D.C. And so first they was claiming there wasn't any. But see, we have somebody working with us and doing all the research and found out, oh, but it is. So then they had this back to me saying, yeah, well, they do have the fund, but it cannot be used. So then we came up with proof that in terms of reobligation of those funds in Aspinall, the federal building in Colorado is an example of reobligated, reobligated funds. And so from that would save at least 70% of the operating costs. Then you have your the next step is the manufacturing community partnership collaboration, and it's a federal agency that tears down all the silos. You understand me? Of federal silos, and for that particular project. And so then from that, they will tear down the different silos that we need to do the work that needs to be done there. And actually, they are waiting and wondering, they're waiting for us to present our package. The third thing is the Innovation Manufacturing Institute, which is bringing back, reinvigorizing a legacy. Marin City had a legacy of shipyards. Our thing is to bring back legacy of innovation, 21st century science. 21st century technology. We have a scientist that is waiting. It's part of the Obama Innovation Hub. Legacy to bring back your science, your academia, and then your
trade.
And so then ours is green. Ours because green. Yeah, because Marin County is what? The green of, you know,
right. 70% okay. Are not leaving.
As well as Golden Gate Village. Golden Gate Village is historic eligible.
Okay. Oh, it is.
And Aaron Green.
National Register.
We're not on the National Register, but we're going to be raising money to get it on the registry. But it's Aaron Green and Frank Lloyd Wright. So from that. You may not have been to the city center.
Aaron Green, you Frank Lloyd Wright.
I have not.
So let me just keep it moving.
Yes.
And so from it being historic eligible,
yes.
Which means it's the same as it being on the National Register.
Sure.
So therefore there's other stepping stones that one must have to go through to move a rock. You know.
And then they're gonna tear down the civic center
and
it's a village.
We've got three out of four categories of historic significance.
Including the site.
Three out of four. The only thing we're missing are Indian heads.
Can I ask you a question? Excuse me. Can I ask you a question? Was this place itself as a whole Marin City established predominantly by black folks?
No, not initially.
It was integrated.
And so
it was integrated from the beginning. That's why it was called Golden.
No,
I'm talking about after white folks left. So they didn't mass leave. So some still stayed.
That's all got the name Golden.
And it's all to
the $1.
Once we get our manufacturing to relocate, then we'll be self-sustaining.
Right. And so those of us who couldn't relocate were stuck in development.
As a resident,
they didn't want to develop.
this property is almost about the housing area redevelopment. I think it's $3.8 million a year.
And then there was, that was all run by the government.
I've had people in person with government corporate for 16 years of landscaping. Ran the business. Our president So that's basically what our plan is. Now, if the housing authority come along with us, we will have the ability to tie up everything.
Sure.
Oh, they won't they have their cake. We will tie it up.
They promised us businesses.
No, that's here, but
they took our flea market away from us.
But that's, yeah.
They took all that land and they've got apartments and houses. They took that away from us and promised that the residents would have an opportunity to live there up on the hill. They did the same thing.
And it's built out.
This is supposed to be phase three of gentrification, isn't it?
No, Marin City is built out.
The community plan.
That's why he got you guys to come out.
Right. No, but Marin City is built out.
How come they don't make you this look at the trust that they do all the other places?
Marin City is built out.
You can't do something on the land.
Marin City is built out.
So, one thing I was going to say is, first of all, one thing that's great is that you guys are thinking for yourself about what you want and figuring out how, how to pay for it, and if you guys were the only one making the decision, this is what it would look like.
Right.
So it would be rehab this way, it would lead to job creation, it would be sustainable because it would be creating future jobs for people, there'd be room for home ownership, there'd be long-term ownership that would allow a way to make sure that the community continues to benefit from it through the land trust. Mm-hmm. Well, I think that is tremendous.
Safe and healthy growth.
But here's the thing, and here's what I'll tell you, from my experience of working with lots of different resident councils and resident groups in lots of different places, is I've never seen a resident council get everything they want in any process. I would say this. I've seen plenty of examples where residence councils have gotten 90% or 85% or 70%, and I've seen situations where it's different. And a lot of it has to do with how well organized are the residents and how broadly shared is the plan. And then let me say this, and I think this is really important. And then how willing is the residents group to engage other members of the working group to get them on board with pieces of the plan?
We've been doing
and here's why I say that, and here's why I say that, because...
That's where attorneys come in.
No, it's fine.
No, but here's why I say that, because, for example, in one example that I have that I know very well, the residents formed, and I mentioned to you this, but the residents formed their own community development corporation. It was a not-for-profit community development corporation.
Right, we have one.
Okay. Yeah. And that community development corporation participated in every piece of the redevelopment that occurred on site. Some of the redevelopment was rehab of all the existing buildings, and some was building new. But in each one of those phases, the CDC that was formed by the residents corporation earned money for the residents corporation. And that money was reinvested back in initiatives that they had. And some of the examples of in this particular case that the residents pushed for, it was a new jobs initiative called Project Match, a new small grants initiative in the community, a new initiative with the schools that the residents had come up with and designed with the schools. So I think it can be done, but a lot of it depends on getting a plan. I actually think that getting a consultant and a lawyer.
We have a consultant.
Okay, good. Who would help you put
getting
the plan?
An attorney is the challenge, and we're in.
I just want to know how do we go forward with this plan?
But, so we need a lawyer. We
viable.
Yeah, we don't have that kind
come
of
up here as a viable.
I'm from a housing authority.
Let me share one other thing.
I'm from a housing authority from Garamagaba. I'm from a housing authority, and this is how we do it.
I think the other thing is that I saw.
We tore down the building.
The other thing that I saw work in other working groups where residents had become well organized and had a plan that a lot of the residents were behind was then that in the working group process, the residents, drawing on resources that they were utilizing, whether it was a consultant or others, were presenting to the working group, presenting their plan to the working group and saying, this is what we want to be.
Let me just say this working group. This working group has Watergate Village residents. It's 1, 2, 3, 4. Out of this little group, 400,000 residents, and out of them, I'm about one been here a year, one's been maybe a year and a half. And then the other one was just raised up here. So I'm just saying that's
I understand, but I would say,
not
what
strong
I would say,
enough.
What I would say to you is that
we
when
need
the
to
proposal,
mobilize the residents.
Mobilize it, hey, and when the proposal is made.
Yes.
I got you.
Okay. We need to have questions.
But this is what I was trying to say earlier about tenant protection, is that that application that goes to HUD, if it doesn't have residents support, it's going to have a hard time getting approved at HUD.
What it is, the reason why. It's Mary and Natasha sit up. There's three of us that are on the resident council
that are here on this thing.
Four. Yes, that's right.
Oh yeah, there's a vacancy. She feels
four.
It is.
Yeah. So there's four of us here, and when it says in terms of residents, they're talking resident council because we are the official voice for the residents of Public
and that's
housing.
Who's supposed to be speaking,
but they don't want it.
Excuse me, groups. Hello? It's time to come back and reconvene in our large group so you can report back. If you would prefer to stay in your resident group, you may.
But do you have anything written in terms of what you've done in a card? So we can, since you're making yourself available.
I'm happy to give you my email address. I'm happy to send you information recently. Now, have it right at that. But I will tell you that I'm in Chicago and I'm married with four small children, so I.
Right. Are you from Chicago?
We're dry here.
That's why there's
no attorneys like you here that help the residents, so they have to import one from Chicago. What you guys need is an attorney like him to work with you and ensure that you have their voice.
I'm happy to share. I've only been here. This is now.
and how it works.
A lot of the things are
Excuse me, can I get you to come back to large group, please?
I thought you said we could decide. Did we decide to go back to the big
Benny Stewart came to see what I did.
Excuse me, Lisa. Did you say we had to decide unanimously to come back?
Yes.
No, majority.
If you don't want to come back to large group, you can stay in your small group.
When we come back, we'll come back. Because we feel we have important information to share.
So Mary has decided to defer the responsibility of reporting out for your group. So first we have group one, who is going to tell us what they talked about and some significant questions that came up in their group.
So I was sitting with group one. They have some really engaging questions and we have some dynamic answers. So I took notes so that the group can continue to focus in on the conversation. So I'm just going to run through some of the questions and responses that we received.
Don't forget your paper. That was
comparing the cost of rehab to redevelopment. So rehabbing versus building new. And part of the response was, well, part of what Mr. Lawson said was that was the first question that they addressed when they began their planning, was do we rehab and keep it the same, or do we do something else? And the feedback based on the numbers was there was not enough money. And we saw this in the budget report, that if we only focus on rehabbing what's currently there with the dollars that HUD has, those dollars won't cover the rehab. So later on, he said very clearly, for example, a historic preservation model will work if it comes with dollars. But he couldn't point us to where those dollars might come from. But he said a historic preservation designation without some type of funding to do the work wouldn't necessarily be a viable plan. So if you're able to rehab with dollars, then you can make it go. Josh asked the question, who drove the deconcentration? So it was some folks were really interested in the idea of spreading out residents who were living in public housing. And so there were some questions about that. What was the impetus behind that? And who was driving that? And so the feedback was that it was driven mainly, or I'll let you correct me where I'm wrong, but definitely city government wanted to see the ability to have residents spread out more dispersely. And there was an issue around affordable housing. They want to increase the number of affordable housing units.
Not just residents, low income.
Low income earners. Also, Mary asked, why deconcentration? So why would you even consider that? And a couple of responses were about more opportunity. So if you have public housing, so we had conversations about having the sticker for your parking, say Golden Gate Village, and then everywhere you drive, everybody knows you're a Golden Gate Village resident, and that could have stigma with people who may look upon public housing in some negative way. And so to deconcentrate would allow residents to live among other mixed income and not be, you know, solely concentrated in public housing. I think also there's another part to that. The way they made sure that they were able to build in other areas of the city was that they made sure that they did not build big developments. So he said about 12 units at a time. And so to avoid the not in my backyard kind of response. And you also get that. So then Homer asked about how did diversity impact the community? So this is a follow-up question to the dispersing of the concentrated affordable housing residents or public housing residents. How did diversity impact the community? Part of the answer was that obviously the mixed income increased diversity, that increased opportunity. And the part I heard that really wasn't about diversity was that mixed income generated revenue that then could be used to maintain and upkeep the public housing units. And then Kevin asked, how do you deal with contention? So Kevin said he's confident that every housing development will have, you know, staunch residents who don't want to see change, some who are unclear and maybe fearful, and some who are open. So the question was, how do you deal with that? Communication was the answer. Mary had an excellent question about if, and this again, we were talking to Mr. Lofton, if in Seattle they prioritize families with children as the first priority for move, for relocation, where did elderly and disabled residents fit into that? He said that they were the second priority. Josh asked, how did you agree as a group? He heard a lot about we agreed, but he was kind of pushing back on that. Was it unanimous? How did that work? The feedback we received was that it was a majority decision, not everyone agreed. Mr. Lofty pointed out that some people will never be open to any change. Some people will need more information to understand what type of change would make sense for them. And once you get a group that understands what's happening, they typically will educate other residents and bring them into the fold. So the communication and information were the two keys. And then I believe that's it.
Thank you very much. Any questions for that group from others?
Could you repeat what you said about the mixed income on this stuff?
Sure. So, go back one. So the question was around diversity with a mixed income model where you have different types of housing, below market, affordable, public, market rate. And so the feedback was when you do that, you obviously are going to get a more diverse group and a more diverse community. But part of what came out of that I heard was that's one way to fund maintenance, rehabilitation, ongoing. So if you have people paying market rate, then you can use that revenue to help those who are in public housing make sure their housing stays up to date.
I just want to ask you,
I apologize for my how did diversity impact the community, the housing development?
Is that based on a community that's not diverse?
This is income diversity. So they went from primarily low income affordable to mixed income that included low up to market rate.
With them on one particular
property. On one particular.
Yes. Being in the group, this was part of the discussion around decentralizing or deconcentrating public housing. And the question specifically was, when you move a small low income group out to a high income neighborhood, how did they fare? Mm-hmm. Right. How did they do? How did diversity impact them?
Well, I mean, but let's be real. We are in where? Where are we? We're not where they are. We're in Marin County. So, with African Americans, what, left 1% or 2% in the county? So, in terms of, so as it relates to diversity, I'm talking about as Marin City, my income. It's still diverse because the Housing Authority does have opportunity where they could bring in other people. But in this valley, that's why you had the Ridgeway, the Marin City townhomes, you got the Ponderosa, the Oak Knolls was supposed to be like the affordable. And then you go up to the Headlands and the Summit now. And the pole houses now that are worth 25 to 50,000 now. Over 1,000% increase. So as a community, we are a very diverse community, more diverse than any community in Marin County. Now to further make us more diverse is gonna be gentrification
because that's where the majority of the of black people live in Marin City, Golden Gate Village. So it would have a very negative impact on us as African Americans in this county, with what, 1% or less than 1% rentals within this county?
I think you're exactly right. So the question of how does diversity impact the community is a question that needs to be asked in Marin City. The answer may not be the same, but that's an important question. Whatever model you guys land on, asking the question, how will this model impact our community and who will potentially be coming here, is an important question.
But in terms of diversity, you're talking income diverse, because Marin City is diverse. Golden Gate Village has become very diverse. So, you know, so you're saying we're in playing in another way, we want to move poor people out of Marin City, scatter them throughout the county.
There's just a question.
I'm just commenting on that question. But if people really knew the political thing in Marin County as it relates to affordable housing or housing for poor people, then that wouldn't even been up here.
All right. So yes, ma'am.
You know, I'm just.
I was just thinking about what just happened with George Lucas, who tried to build, you know, to give it away his ranch, and ended up having to buy his build on his own property, low income housing, because
they fought it.
They all kind of fought it. So one of the things is, Mr. Lofton's internet, he was excited in Seattle that the lower income people were in this section. They kind of moved in that section.
Right.
And I was wondering the same thing. This is the only kind of, you know, section where we don't have much in every other place around here.
That's right.
And I'm from there. And I know that it would be uncomfortable for a lot of folks move in the middle of San Anselmo after they've been here in Marin City. So yeah, I'm concerned about that as well.
Okay.
Questions that was asked, once again, and listen, the question was after the community was rebuilt and they built in the mixed income units, how was it impacted? Because as you build in more units into the community that exists, the lower income, the mixed income units, by people moving in, that make more money living in the same community. Mm-hmm. How did that affect them on the diversity impact community? But it had nothing to do with moving people across Marin County and moving to San Anselmo. We all know that we live here. 1% of whatever you want to call it, there's people spread out all over this county. In this county, that it's not going to happen. They don't care if you're George Lucas or Luke Skywalker. you're not going to build here. So when we say Marin County, we already know what we were talking about. Strictly the question was about what would happen if when they rebuild in their community, when they added more units because the density went up, how did it affect the community on the diversity question?
Okay, and I need us to be mindful of time, and I need the other groups to have time to report back. So can we move to group two's report back so we can hear from residents as well? So who's reporting for group two? Thank you, group one, for your work and your questions and report backs.
So first, I wanted to thank you, Segura. You were great. We had a great conversation, very interesting, very informative. Thank you, CEO, for taking these notes. I'm going to try to get through what we did, but it was much more of a dialogue. And so we hit a lot of points and we discussed a lot of things, and I think it was very productive. So one of the first questions that came up was again about financing, mm-hmm. and how we could do the renovations. And we were told that, you know, there in the past there were ARRA funds, which no longer exist, which were helpful, because at some point they were getting $10 million in ARRA funds. Those funds don't exist anymore. But to rehab units, when they were doing about 250 units, they used, for their HOPE grant, they used a lot of HUD money. And I think that was pretty much it. Most of it was coming primarily from HUD. And residents lived in the construction zone, in some cases, for the entire period of time, which can be a very long period of time. But what they did was they first built the new construction housing, the new houses, the new units, and they started with seniors. And they looked at the seniors and they talked to the seniors and they asked the seniors, what did they need? Some of the seniors were in 2-3 level homes,
some were not conducive to the kind of living that they had grown into because they'd been there for a long period of time. So the seniors were allowed to move into some of the new units to accommodate them. And then slowly from that point, they were moving people in and out as new developments and new units were being put into place. We asked, well, how many of the residents actually returned, again, by choice. And we were told that 40% of the residents originally in public housing actually returned, which means that 60% chose not to return. And when we asked why it was they chose not to, he said that it comes into a variety of reasons. Some people had their vouchers and used those vouchers to move closer to homes, or they made personal decisions to start a new life elsewhere. And some people just decided that they were going to move, start their life there, because they didn't want to live through 2 or 3 years of construction. So a lot of people had a lot of different reasons for moving. We asked what some of the benefits of the mixed income units were, and the way we defined mixed units were public housing, about a third was public housing, about a third was affordable housing, which in Marin County, as you know, is still a very high income level, and then there was market rate housing in all of them. Some of the designs included on the bottom floor some commercial, I think it was the commercial units, so that people could have stores and outlets and retail there. And some of the complexes actually used those for nonprofits, where they brought in entrepreneurial groups to come in and help do some economic development work and to help people get skills and job training. And I think he even mentioned that one of the groups there brought in training for kids to learn how to do music and things. But again, they talked to the residents and they got feedback from the residents from the very beginning around what was going to be important to those residents, not sort of what they do kind of across the board. And because they were so engaged with it, it took a lot of time. But it did bring construction jobs into the neighborhood. It brought childcare because residents said they needed childcare to help support. There was a workforce component. When I say, I'm sorry, I should have said there was a workforce development income. So people who actually worked in the county or worked wherever they did and were making basic wages. And they had small business classes. They had a commercial kitchen, where residents were actually learning to do catering. They actually started a cafe in one of their units. They had a community that was sort of developing itself and working with the nonprofits to figure out what it was that they wanted on that kind of bottom floor. They were also, this was a question about CDBG funding. The reason this question came up was we wanted to ensure that there would be one-to-one trade-off. So I mean, take down a unit, you put up another unit of public housing, and the CDBG funding would also be part of the HUD funding, and that would guarantee that. And wanted to know how effective the projects were in terms of expanding it to affordable housing and mixed income. And he pointed out there are two different things. For residents, again, and we've heard this and we know it. I know the resident at the working group knows this and hold it near and dear. Displacement and the return policy is key. Every resident who's here, we all know, needs to be able to stay here, to come back here, and needs to be accommodated as part of their return or their realignment policy when they move out. So their relocation choices are there. They wanted to make sure that the disabled and the aging people in place were accommodated. And again, going back to that model, they offered the seniors the first opportunity to move, and they created space where there was elevators, more ADA accessible building. And one of the other effects of affordable housing or having the mixed income housing was that it brought in more business and more investments from other people, because as you have public housing, individuals not able to pay sort of the actual cost of the housing, and you have affordable housing and you have market rate housing, that generates revenue to offset and allow for other repairs and everything, and I think this is what the first group said as well, to help out and subsidize the public housing homes.
They're not going to.
Oh.
One of the questions that I was asked also was, could we give priority, if we did this, could we give priority to Marin City residents who have moved out of Marin City, who now want to come back? And we have to be very careful about that, he said, because, and I, since I work in fair housing in the county, I know this, but we can't say only certain people can live here or move back here because that would be discriminatory, of course. But one of the things that we could talk about is looking at the waiting list that we have for housing here at the Housing Authority, and start looking at people and seeing if they would be interested in moving into some of these units. So that would also add a little bit of diversity in a different way. So how did the residents react to the mixed income? There were people who were concerned that the community would change so much and that people would not be welcoming to each other or know that, you know, how it would be. And one of the design elements, of course, was they didn't have all the public housing in this building, all the, you know, the affordable housing in that unit, and all the market rate housing in another unit. It was all mixed in. So you wouldn't know. You'd be living next door to somebody who's in public housing, somebody who was in a fireman and somebody else, and you wouldn't know necessarily just by the unit what they did. But they also worked very closely to create community. They created community garden and urban farming. They have dog parks, playgrounds. They have a bike share program that residents could use. They did a lot of, and working again with the nonprofits and with the citizens themselves, came up with a lot of community building activities. When they were going through the design phase, which was pretty extensive, they would have different phases and residents would have comment on all of it. So they would show them three plans. Everybody would come on and they come back and they redesign it and they show them, okay, here's two designs that were a consolidation of your feedback. By doing that, in this one case, for people in Colorado, which is where this gentleman is from, it was important that they have kind of a mudroom. I don't know if California people know what mudroom is, some of these places know what it is. You have your washer, your dryer, your boots, your tubs, and all that kind of stuff there, and your skis and your kids' stuff and everything, and that was very important to the residents, so they actually designed the units to include that. So how were the residents engaged? He said it was a very extensive process, a very long process. At the beginning of it, there was a vision that was identified and defined by everyone. At the end, there was a master plan. There was a whole lot of discussion in between, but once they got to the master plan, they actually compare it to the original ideas that came up and most people want me to talk about, but I don't talk too much probably. And could renters, could people in public housing, could people in affordable housing, could people who live there ultimately become homeowners. And in fact, there's a group, I wrote this down specifically because I thought it was really cool. They have a home buyers club, which sort of incorporates BMRs and IDAs, if you know what those things are, where individuals could actually begin to get capacity for home ownership. As you know, it takes a long time to do that, but because the process takes so long, there is a process in place, and this group actually works with residents to help them get that whole process started so that in time they have their credit, they have their job situated, they're able, and they can move into any of these units, I guess from public housing to affordable housing or from affordable housing into the market rate housing. And so all of those things are available. In fact, one of those groups that they worked with identified 20% of the units had to be built so that people, in this case in Marin City, would be able to move into affordable housing,
affordable as in Marin County standards.
I think that was it.
Okay. Thank you, Liz. And now I would like to open it up to the floor for additional questions for either that working group, and then we'll move to the resident group. So does anyone else have any questions for this group?
I have a question for her, real quick.
Yes.
I mean, Liz Darby.
Yes, 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 Liz Darby, yes.
Okay, so you said that last part you talked about, they built units that were different? So that they could be purchased.
Like a condo? Is that what you're
Yeah, here we go. We'll let Mr. Guerrero answer that.
Just in case.
I had explained that in our, when we redeveloped the property, not only did we bring back rental units, but we also added home ownership units or for sale units in the community, in the same community. And of those for sale units, 20% had to be affordable, and the priority went to people.
So they were somewhere, they were not a part of the complex, they were in the community surrounding the complex.
In our case, they were on the site, on the same site as the public.
Oh, so they're on the same site?
Yep.
Okay.
We were talking about, we were redeveloping like a 6-block area, so probably, you know, similar size to what you have here.
Okay.
We were at about 15 acres.
On that side, I got one more question. So, I guess it's my sick thinking, and I don't mind saying it, but I have a hard time believing that a person that's doing really well economically would want to live next to somebody who isn't. So when you said, you guys said you did this thing where you, is that why you mixed it up? And so how do people keep from not knowing, like okay, I'm rich, I'm you know, I'm doing really well, and I'm paying more rent to so that she can stay here? You know, how does that?
You'd have to come to Denver, and I'd be happy to show you.
Really?
But it works.
And people don't like.
Nope.
There's no resentment. She's paying $5, and I'm paying $50. You know what I'm saying?
Happens all
over. Really?
Happens all over.
Yeah. Wow. You know what? I need to have a little bit more confidence.
You only have 5 or 6 people that were there before in that neighborhood, and they won't be there long.
Okay.
Homer has a question, but I want to do one clarification. And Mr. Guerrero, let me know if I'm correct. When we're talking in the beginning about how did you finance renovations, when we're talking about HUD money, you were specifically speaking of Hope 6 money, and Hope 6 money is no longer available, correct?
Choice.
Now it's Choice Neighborhoods money, which if working group members recall from our last panel discussion, the folks from Alameda talked about how they're using Choice Neighborhoods to fund their redevelopment strategy right now. Any other questions for this group?
I have one on the choice.
Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, my question is to you. The choice program is similar to the Hope 6. Well, in Hope 6, a lot of residents got displaced nationwide when the affordability of the housing wasn't at their level, when they were paying 30% of income. Affordable housing is not always affordable for very low-income people and extremely low-income. So nationwide, a lot of people got displaced. Is a choice program similar to the choice Hope 6 in that people can get displaced if they can't afford the level of quote-unquote affordability?
I'll just say one thing, and Andrew can correct me if I get it wrong. I think it's important to note when we talk about replacement housing, it's generally talking about the subsidized units. So replacing a public housing unit with another public housing unit, not a public housing unit with an affordable unit. So that's number one. It's they're comparable units, subsidized units, subsidized housing. And the history of the Hope 6 program goes back so far that there's been a lot of, I would say, changes, improvements, you know, feedback. And most of us are doing one-for-one replacement and having much more, less displacement. Every city is different, so. And also, like I said, in our case, 60% of residents chose to move. So you could call it displacement. They called it a choice to not come back to the same community.
So are you
telling me it's hard for people to find affordable housing? Very hard. Yep. So if they get displaced, really nowhere to go.
Yeah, that right here is a problem in Marin County.
That's what
Okay.
Yeah. So are you saying there was a Hope 6, and then there's what
choice.
You're talking
choice
about.
Choice neighborhood.
Choice. Okay,
right.
So what you're saying is that one doesn't replace the other.
So Hope 6 is no longer available. Hope 6 sunset like 2 years ago, right?
But I'm just trying to make sure I understand what he's saying. It's affordable housing and subsidized housing.
Right.
So one wouldn't
right. You replace
wipe out the other.
You replace subsidized housing with subsidized housing.
has to be the same type of subsidy.
Right, that's where we get the one-to-one replacement.
So she's saying, you're saying in your case it was affordable housing terminology with you, and a lot of people still couldn't qualify with the term affordable housing as opposed to low income?
Yes.
Right.
Really?
Nationwide, there's a low income limit.
I thought affordable kind of protected you.
Celine, can we make note of this so we can move on to our next group? So that we can come back to this question at some point, and I got Homer first, Aura, and then you, and then we're moving on to resident group.
Well, you know, y'all report back.
So, Homer.
My question was she said that was about homeownership and realistically, I would also ask this question. Most people living in low income housing on fixed income, SSI, SDI, and then you have some people that might qualify for homeownership that retired and have a pension. So the reality of someone living in low income moving to homeownership, I mean, you know, you've got to like justify the logic of what you're saying.
If it's workforce housing though, I'm home, do you think? The only reason I asked is because there was some excitement in the group around, and they were young, and they're working, and they're building towards a future, and right now, perhaps they are in public housing, or they could afford affordable housing, but given that they're young, and they have time, and they have opportunities, they saw this as an opportunity for them to actually buy into the community they wanted to live in. And it does take time, but it's sort of like a BMR right now, right? Some people can do that, no matter where they live. Now, it takes a lot of discipline, and there's a lot of steps you have to do, but I think that's where they were going, more kind of a workforce.
So you have two residents here who are both, were interested in.
Right. You know. And first I got Aura, and then Barbara? Okay.
So I had just a couple of questions to help me out. How long has this model of the mixed income been used in the United States? I understand the term decentralized poverty, but what about decentralizing wealth? That's the second question. And the third question is, I know that Mr. Lewis has said we cannot add any more public housing units. That's that, we've got 500. But yet we have, 5,000 people on the waiting list? And my question is, because I'm on the RAF, one of the goals and objectives is housing 70 public housing families a year. That's, you put 70 over 500, that's about 14% that they think are either gonna die, be moved out or something. My question is, why can't we enjoin the question of more public housing, and secondly, decentralizing wealthy communities so that people, the children and the elders of the people who are wealthy will be able to buy public housing units in Ross.
Right.
Just a question.
Who wants to take that? Mr. Guerrero?
Black unity.
And then I'm going to take Barbara's question, and then we're going to move on to the resident group.
I'm sorry, I don't recall all your questions.
So the first question is the precedent and how long and what?
Yeah, thank you. So, I don't know, I can't remember exactly how far back it goes. Our first mixed income community came online about 1998. And it's been successful in moving, you know, been successfully occupied, even through the downturns. Market rate as well as the public housing units have all been, so our experience is from 98. You have to elect the right people to Congress if you want to get more public housing units. I'll just stop there because it's funded out of Washington and they don't fund any more public housing. We do, to your point, we are bringing market rate residents into low-income communities. So that is how we're diversifying low-income communities, by bringing more market rate people into those neighborhoods, not the other way around. And that's the model we've been using.
What do you think about the model of decentralizing wealth and the conversation of inequity in terms of what's going on and the very, very rich and the very, very poor and the lack of the middle class, which I think we really need to begin to talk about, you know, and Liz, you're talking about home ownership, that, oh, that's the middle class. I mean, that's where we really begin to have a robust economy is when we build our middle class.
I totally agree.
I would say I think there are some examples of the deconcentrating of wealth. I mean, on a very small scale, obviously George Lucas tried to do that, and that was very tough. But in other parts of the country, I mean, other parts of California, in other parts of the country, you can see that. One example I would just give from Chicago actually was where, with redevelopment of one public housing site, actually where the residents were very involved in driving the process, the surrounding neighborhood around public housing was a very, very affluent high-end neighborhood. And the residents, with the support of the local aldermen, were successful in getting every new development that went up in that affluent neighborhood around where the public housing development sat to get a 20% affordable housing set aside in every new development. And half of that 20% affordable housing set aside was set aside for public housing families coming off the waiting list. And so you actually had public housing families in Chicago moving into a very wealthy community into new housing, and it was an example of deconcentrating wealth, but on a small scale, obviously. But yeah,
and that's happened in other places.
Oh yeah,
where folks, you know, when you're, especially when you're using public dollars to do a private development, sometimes San Francisco does it, where you say, you know, we're building 400 units of market rate housing, but if you're using some kind of public funds, there's a set aside that says maybe 20% of those market rate units have to be. It's never enough, but I'm saying that's an example of that.
And I'd actually say in a number of the examples in Chicago, it was actually no public money involved, but Walter Burnett, who's the alderman for that area, grew up in public housing, and he made it a priority to try to create more opportunities for public housing residents in some of the, you know, wealthier neighborhoods on the north side, and he succeeded because he was just willing to be
tough about it. And how's that going?
Some other municipalities have enacted legislation that requires that.
How's that going? Can I just, thank you.
I'm just repeating what they had said.
So Barbara, we're going to take the last question from Barbara, and then we're going to move on to Royce's report back from the resident group. Yes? Okay.
Just a comment that we do have examples of mixed use in Marin County. The fact that no one's aware of it is pretty enlightening, because if I think of the example out in behind the Civic Center, if anyone's familiar with it, there's a large housing development out there. They have EAH owns some of the buildings there, some of the units, and their voucher, families that have vouchers there, they have VMR units and they have market rate. It's all mixed and it works really well. And there's other areas in the county as well. So I think we have some local models. I mean, they're not public housing units, but they're voucher units that really highlight that it can work. And then we have enough national models as well.
Thank you, Barbara. Royce. Mm-hmm. You want this?
Yeah.
And Celine, can I get you to record?
Okay. Our group, coming from a resident standpoint, and we had the opportunity to really talk to Nick in terms of, and found out that actually he's here on one thing, but I guess in Chicago he represents residents. So what we did, we shared with Nick our resident plan, and it's a real plan. For those of you that don't know what our plan is, especially to these gentlemen here, the Golden Gate Village Resident Council, we have a plan of historic preservation. In fact, Golden Gate Village is historic eligible. We don't have the money yet, but we're raising the money to put it on the National Registry. You're looking at Aaron Green and Frank Lloyd Wright designs over there. At the same time, I might add, when the Civic Center was built, Aaron Green was doing both at the same time because Frank Lloyd Wright had passed away before the development era. So, with that being said, as well as the Civic Center is now up on the heritage list, but they need $21 million of repair just for the roof. So I maintain that if Golden Gate Village, what we've heard from 15 to 31 at the last month, million of renovation, but I think they made a mistake.
So I know that they could come up with that, $17 million, to do the renovation. But our plan is actually...
They can come up with $17 million.
And is that for the structure or the whole rebrand?
Well, all I know is from what, from the P&A. The P&A for that first 1 year of the renovation, of the deferred maintenance that they have intentionally allowed to get in that state is $17 million. That's what they told me. But then last month they said $21 million. $31 million, excuse me.
Yes.
Depends on who you ask. Okay.
So when you said they can get $17 million, I'm trying to
count. Oh, who's they? The county, our board of supervisors. They are the they. Because why they are looking for $21 million to and they say they're coming along with that, then they can preserve the other work and tearing down that false border of Golden Gate Village as it relates with the Civic Center. But in our plan is in terms of threefold. Golden Gate Village, we have a plan, but it's not a one-time fix. Our plan creates a path of local growth, a growth for a local economy with shared ownership of wealth. Now, what does that mean? That means that as it relates to the deferred maintenance, we have a sliver of an opportunity of the $14 million of the deferred maintenance of the ARRA funds that have not been expended. We've heard all kinds of stories, but first it didn't exist, but our consultant found evidence that it exists. Then two, it cannot be reobligated, but those funds have been reobligated with the Aspinall Federal Building in Colorado. With that, it is 70%. When they did that, the retrofitting of that federal building saved 70% of the operating costs. Two, in terms of capacity building, we propose what is called a manufacturing partnership collaborative. What this agency, it's a federal agency. So what this agency does is actually tear down the silos in various federal departments in DC to make your project go forth. Okay? So what does that mean? That means if you, our plan, and we are ready to submit our plan. We've done the playbook on our plan already to submit to the MCP people. Once that happens, that department, it was created to revolutionize how agencies can access federal dollars without going through, you know, the silo here and the silo there. Okay, so from that comes the Innovative Manufacturing Institute, which is what we are proposing as our plan for sustainability to bring back legacy, because Marin City was noted for shipbuilding. Nick even knew that. And but ours is green, a green manufacturing center. Then that would be used to do the retrofitting of Golden Gate Village. We already have a scientist with us. We do have to outreach to either College of Marin or Dominican College to create that 21st century curriculum for the science that is going to 21st century science, which would be on the job training, apprenticeship program. And we're talking about the apprenticeship program that President Obama, the American Apprenticeship Act, so where people in fact could be on the job training, learning this, but they're not making $10 an hour. They're making that middle class money. Not middle class for Marin County, but middle class money to make it creating our own middle class from within instead of bringing in people from the outside to create diversity as it relates to income diversity, because our complex is already diversified. So with that, you have an opportunity not only for apprenticeships, but jobs, as well as opportunities for folks, for small businesses coming from offshoots from the Innovation Hub. We will be getting in contact with Nick, and he has promised, promised the information. That's all I'm at. I'm not saying you're coming here. No. Get it? That's all I'm asking for. Yeah.
What I had said in the group, as the residents put forward a lot of their different ideas and thoughts about what they'd like to see, is I shared a couple things. One, as I said, I've seen lots of different ideas in different redevelopments where residents have gotten engaged and put forward their proposals and their vision for what they think the redevelopment should look like. And I encourage the residents here to do the same. And I said one of the best things I think that can happen in the working group process, wherever it's taking place, is for residents to get organized together and to have a vision and to put it forward and to engage deeply with the working group to share that vision. Because the best way that you're going to come up with a process that ends with something that everybody believes in, where you can break down some historic barriers between different parts of the community and those who have lived in public housing, is by having residents well organized with a vision and engaging in that working group and building a vision together with others. So I will definitely get you ideas and examples.
Thank you. And lastly, I would like to say that Dwayne.
Yes, ma'am.
Dwayne has said it last month, but it was a lot going on last month. But Dwayne has said between now and the next meeting that RDJ will help the resident council, because we're fighting this battle with our hands behind our back, but we got him on our side, so we push it forward. But he said that he would help us as residents get the word out to our residents, so our residents can hear our plan, and we'll, you know, go over it and over it and over it again. If we had a space on the complex, that wouldn't be necessary, but of course that would be the right thing. So he's agreed that he's going to help us get the word out. We'll have a barbecue at the Rocky Graham Park and on a nice afternoon to get the word out to more and more of our residents. And in closing, that was brought up is that not only is Marin City, just for everybody who doesn't know it, it's already built out. Marin City is built out. Challenge you to go read information. We are built out. And if it does come on down, it would be interesting just to see when we have a truly in Marin City community engagement. There's be some surprises. Okay.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Thank you, Royce.
Real quick question for clarification. 14 million from which?
AARRA
fund.
But can you tell us what the AARA stands for?
It was the Obama money.
Oh, the stimulus money. That's the apprenticeship training funds. Okay.
And that money will go back to the general treasury next month. And of course, what is $14 million when you've got a multi-hundred millions of dollars worth of property?
So, that's right. You know.
Thank you, Royce. Is there anyone who has questions for the resident working group? LaDasha.
I just want to know, do any of you gentlemen know about the $14 million in funds that is still available? I know you guys said that the money's gone.
They don't know none of
that. They don't know about our money. They're
I meant the AAR federal money. Do they know anything about it?
No.
We've seen it used in lots of places.
You've seen it used?
Yes, we've seen it used in lots of places.
Do you know how we get access to it?
I don't know if any, I mean, when you brought it up in the working group, I did not know there was any still available, so I don't know.
No, it's left over.
Right, I know you, that it hasn't been used, right?
No, it hasn't.
Any other?
We'll be going back to the treasury.
Beverly, give me a question.
Yeah, we, as out of all the people that have come to these panels.
I'm sorry, we can't hear Beverly, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Beverly.
So just you three, because I didn't ask it to nobody else. The demographics, have you done you did a little research about the demographics here economically and culturally? How does that compare to any of your situations that you have now engaged in, have engaged in the past? Because the situation here is, this being the second richest county in the United States of America, mm-hmm. So we have a racism thing, mm-hmm. big time, mm-hmm. and then we have an economic divide. You got the real dirt poor here, and the real rich over there. So how does that compare to, and a lot of things gets blocked. George Lucas couldn't do what he wanted to do because somebody with some money said no. So how did you run up against any challenges like that? You got a lot of that in Chicago.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We have the Douglas, yeah. But there's those extremes and those problems. I don't know Marin County or Marin City as well as you do, as well as others in the room. But I know from Denver, we have those extremes, you know, right between downtown, which is less than a mile from our Mariposa district.
Oh, yeah, you did say it was surrounded here. Because I think the issue with what Royce is trying to do and what everybody else does, it seems like the interest is in getting the big bucks as opposed to looking after the people. That's what it looks like.
You know, we want to preserve people.
Yeah, hers is a slow process. It looks after people, to take care of people. And then there's this other process that says there's some money to be made. There's some money to be made. That's what we want to do, is make money.
So I also don't know Marin County's demographics as well as you all do. Seattle is faced with the same income disparity as others are. I don't know the comparison to Marin County. But we are one of the fastest growing, economically growing areas in the country. We have roughly, our population is roughly 8.5% African American, 11% Asian, 9% Hispanic, Latino. So we have a significant racial divide in Seattle as well. And our affordable housing crisis has become just that, a crisis where folks who are working in Seattle often can't afford a unit in Seattle. So we're facing similar issues and they're trying to address those by creating more affordable housing for affordable housing as opposed to subsidized housing, because subsidized housing comes with federal subsidies for the most part, and that's capped. But affordable housing that is lower cost for residents so that who live in Seattle, more will be able to afford that. But it's a problem I think most cities are facing today.
People we got running for president and Republican Party. How will we get these dollars? I mean, it doesn't even sound realistic. And because what we're saying here is that they're already trying to tear down what he's put up. And then in the situation with the federal government already cutting back on housing authority money, the fact is that when we say that these dollars out here, they should be fact-driven and just not put out there and people believe they should forgive them, because there's going to be a process. Republicans control Congress is not going to give up any dollars.
I want to say, in response to Homer's question or comment, is that what I'm talking about, this is supported by Republicans as well as Democrats on both sides of the aisle as it relates to getting the innovation and manufacturing hub, as well as the manufacturing collaboration.
I'm speaking about the apprenticeship money.
That is the first, until he's gone, probably, more likely. But the thing of it is, once we have our building over there, as I'm looking over there, that is going to be our money maker. And I just want to, let everybody know that we as in Golden Gate Village Resident Council, we have a patent on our plan as it relates to that, because that is going to be our money maker.
That's the one over here, that's the one over here, that's over there.
The old Best Buy building.
Best Buy.
Oh,
in that area.
Okay, well, I think people need to know.
Oh, that's in the Best Buy.
In the old Best Buy building or in the area?
Depending, but.
Okay. And I'm gonna give the last comment for the evening to Mr. Guerrero, because we're already at 8:30 or a little past 8:30. I want to thank everyone for your time tonight, Mr. Guerrero. Here you go.
I just sort of want to let Homer's comment slip, especially for all of us in the room here, which is, because he asked a very important question, which is, I don't think you want people leaving the room tonight and talking about a $14 million silver bullet that's, waiting in D.C. So I think it's very important that, I don't know, like I said, if there's research to be done, get to the facts. I'm not sure that money's out there. If it requires an act of Congress, regardless, I can almost guarantee you it's not going to happen, because this Congress is just not approving anything right now. But I think there's research to be done potentially, but just to be careful, or to be mindful for everybody here that ARRA funding was kind of one-time money. People may know more about it and where the money's available, but just to you always want to be mindful about expectations that are created.
Well, thank you all for your work tonight in small groups, for community members and working group members. You did some really great work tonight. We will see you next month. We will be the third Monday in September. Yes, folks? Okay. You will get the dates of the next two meetings for calendars. And again, thank you for your time tonight. Thank you, gentlemen, for your time and your expertise.